My name's Tina Campt, and welcome back from our break. I hope everyone is fortified for our final panel. This panel is entitled Situating Transnational Feminism in a Changing Theoretical Landscape. And we have, let's see, one, two, three, four, five panelists joining us today. I'm not going to do the full introductions because that would take up too much time. I'm just going to introduce everybody by name initially, and then we're going to go in the order in the program as well as the order of the table. So our first panelist is Attiya Ahmad, who's assistant professor of anthropology at George Washington University. Nadia Fadil, Toby Beauchamp is an assistant professor of gender and women's studies at Oklahoma State University. Nadia Fadil is an assistant professor at the Interculturalism, Migration, and Minorities Research Center at the KU Leuven in Belgium. And Tate LeFevre is an assistant professor of anthropology at Franklin and Marshall College. And our last panelist is Shayoni Mitra, who is our own assistant professor of theater here at Barnard. Please join me in welcoming all of our panelists. And I'm going to give the podium over to Attiya, our first speaker.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Before I begin, a big thank you to BCRW, and in particular, Catherine Semeh, Anne Jonas, and Pam Phillips, and of course, Janet Jacobson, for making this event possible. I'm incredibly grateful and delighted to be here. My paper title is a rather long title, so just bear with me, and hopefully it'll make sense, you know, as my paper unfolds. So it's entitled From Binaries to Configurations, Conversions to Transformations, Transnational Feminist Approaches to Muslim Women's Religious Experiences. So in my primary fields of study, centering on Muslim women's religious experiences, it is often hard to hear the vibrant theoretical discussions feminists are currently engaged in over the din and clamor of discourses that remain rooted in a conceptual framework of radical alterity. Like other scholars focusing on Muslim groups in Islam, in the post-9/11 period, I've struggled against hegemonic discourses that portray Islam in the West as immutably and implacably different, particularly where gender relations are concerned. Not only do these discourses actively produce what they envision themselves as merely describing, they constitute the basis from which most academic discussions about Islam, from grant proposals to class lectures, and even this presentation, inevitably take place. Critical scholarship on Muslims and Islamic movements draw our attention to the Orientalist and Islamophobic underpinnings of these popular discourses. So one trajectory of work challenges the characterization of Muslims and Islamic movements as being intrinsically patriarchal, violent, and resistant or unable to adapt to democracy and modernity. Another trajectory of works provincialize the seemingly universal categories through which we apprehend and analyze these populations and movements, demonstrating that our understanding of modernity, religion, secularism, and agency are socioculturally and historically located. While the first set of works reverses the negative evaluation, and the second set of works unsettles the taken-for-granted concepts through which we analyze and assess Muslims and Islamic movements, both trajectory of scholarship are predicated on the same underlying assumption that Islam and the West are radically incommensurate. Seba Mahmoud's scholarship on a mosque-based women's Islamic piety movement in Cairo is a prominent example. Her scholarship is arguably the most influential work on Islam and Muslims over the past decade, inspiring similar analyses and establishing the conceptual framework through which scholarship on Muslim groups and Islamic movements are assessed. Based on ethnographic research she conducted in the late 1990s, Mahmoud brilliantly discusses how her interlocutors' embodied religious practices are not simply a reflection of their inner states of belief, but are the very means, which she describes as the ineluctable means, through which pious dispositions and subjectivities are cultivated. Through her analysis, Mahmoud demonstrates how religious piety is not reducible to individual belief, an understanding of religiosity that is resonant with secularizing discourses that seek to relegate religion to the realm of private practice. Mahmoud's work draws from and furthers a long trajectory of anthropological work that parochializes modern Western conceptions of the sovereign slash liberal subject by demonstrating how subjects are not always already constituted individuals focused on their own self-interest and cost-benefit modes of decision-making. Rather, subjects are formed in relation to historically situated discursive formations and disciplinary apparatuses. Mahmoud's work focuses our attention on how her interlocutors' pious subjectivities are cultivated in relation to the Islamic discursive tradition, an analysis that draws from Foucault's writings on the ethical formation and technologies of the self. In so doing, her work points to how Cairene women's religious experiences, even in relation to a religious tradition she describes as patriarchal, does not stifle their agency, but constitutes an altogether different form thereof. She argues that the form of agency her interlocutors enact, and here I'm quoting from her, a capacity of action that historically specific relations of subordination enable and create, close quote, is fundamentally incommensurable from the understandings of agency that undergirds feminist scholarship, quote, one conceptualized in terms of resistance to social norms, and, quote again, the capacity to realize one's own interest against the weight of custom, tradition, transcendental will, or other obstacles, whether individual or collective. By privileging and naturalizing their own understanding of agency, feminists not only allied Cairene women's religious experiences, they also set the basis from which these experiences are evaluated. Mahmoud's analysis strongly resonates with post-colonial critiques and critiques of second-wave feminisms, both of which point to how the seemingly universal category of human and woman are in fact universalizing discourses that appropriate and make it difficult to account for a broader range of sociopolitical experiences that are not reducible to those of the modern liberal West or of Western middle-class and heterosexual white women. Mahmoud's intervention is insightful and important, yet she presents her analysis in an overly exaggerated form. Her anti-essentialist critique of hegemonic understandings of agency is predicated on a reductive essentializing of feminism, the liberal modern West, and the Islamic discursive tradition. Mahmoud conflates feminist understandings of agency with those of the liberal modern West and posits the two as radically different and incommensurate from those of the Islamic discursive tradition. Her analysis reconstitutes the anthropological cross-cultural model, here repackaged as a cross-discursive model, and effectively reinscribes an Orientalist division between Islam and the West. Transnational feminisms, I'd like to argue, offers a more supple and comprehensive analytic framework in examining Muslim women's religious experiences. Rather than eliding, appropriating, or denigrating difference as universalizing discourses do, and rather than assuming and reifying differences as cross-discursive models do, transnational feminisms analyze how differences are produced and reconstituted through sociopolitical processes and historical interrelations. They do so by decentering phenomena. Transnational feminist approaches constitute a critical mode of inquiry that eschews what Eve Sedgwick has referred to as paranoid readings and strong theory, where there's an emphasis on one set of factors or issues in our analysis. Watershed works, most notably Scattered Hegemonies by Inderpal Grewal and Karen Kaplan, push us to consider multiple issues and their interrelations simultaneously, and they push us to develop modes of multidimensional analysis and writing. In my analysis of South Asian migrant domestic workers who develop newfound Islamic pieties in Kuwait, transnational feminist approaches have helped me to go beyond the analytic framework of religious conversion, a conceptual approach that is similar to cross-cultural or cross-discursive frameworks in positing two discrete religious traditions that the subject and convert switches between. Instead of analyzing conversion as a site where differences between Islam and other religious traditions are reinforced, for example, by a convert who develops a chauvinist understanding of their newfound religion, or by polemicists who write about these conversions. So rather than thinking about this as a site where differences between religious traditions are reinforced, or as a site of syncretism, for example, where the convert practices a religion or religious practices that mark the blending of different religious traditions. My work traces how domestic workers' newfound Islamic pieties index broader transformations in their relationships, subjectivities, and belongings. Transformations that point to the complex ways in which religious precepts and practices are related to other realms of experience. Domestic workers develop newfound pieties through their everyday migration experiences, one centered on household spaces. As Mahmoud discusses in her work, Islamic practice is not relegated to particular times or spaces of formal rituals. The cultivation of religious piety suffuses the everyday in a variety of forms, including the performance of daily prayers, veiling practices, and the enactment of patience and modesty. Although she foregrounds the everyday, Mahmoud only examines her interlocutors' everyday utterances and activities in relation to Islamic precepts. She treats her interlocutors' everyday experiences as the raw materials through which pious dispositions and subjectivities are formed. What if, following transnational feminists, we were to disaggregate the everyday and look at other discourses and sociopolitical phenomena in addition to the Islamic ethical self-formation that also shapes the cultivation of Muslim pieties? What if, following Eve Sedgwick, we were to look at what lies alongside or beside the Islamic discursive tradition in the process of Islamic ethical formation? The ecological field through which pious subjectivities develop, rather than place temporal emphasis on repetition only in relation to Islamic precepts. South Asian migrant domestic workers' development of newfound Islamic pieties is inextricable from their everyday work within Kuwaiti households, their affective and intimate laboring, which entails the disciplining and reshaping of their personalities and comportment. It is also underpinned by a gendered discourse of South Asian women being netum, an intrinsic capacity and learned capability of women to be shaped by and to adjust to their surroundings. Domestic workers becoming Muslim marks transformations in their subjectivities that develop not only through their practice of Islam, but also through their affective laboring and gendered discourses emphasizing their malleability. Domestic workers' experience becoming Muslim gradually and processually, where their newfound Islamic pieties develop in relation rather than in opposition to their existing belongings. They develop Islamic pieties by learning Islamic precepts and practices and re-engaging their lives in relation to these, a process that is neither unidirectional nor linear, but cyclical and recursive. Piety is achieved through a constant striving, a constant tacking back and forth between Islamic precepts and practices and the stuff of everyday life through which these precepts and practices are apprehended, approached, and actualized. For domestic workers, the stuff of everyday life necessarily includes their pre-existing languages, religious traditions, familial relations, and other forms of belonging, including those based on ethnicity and nationality. Becoming Muslim is not experienced as a renouncing, rejecting, or supplanting of their existing relationships, sociocultural practices, and belongings, but as a reworking and re-engagement thereof. It is a dynamic and encompassing process in which the boundaries between Islam, other religious traditions, and forms of belonging are experienced as porous and fluid. Domestic workers develop forms of Muslim belongings in which differences between themselves and their employers, others in Kuwait, and their family members in their home communities are not elided, erased, or reinforced, but are reconfigured through their Islamic practice. Now, while domestic workers' newfound Islamic pieties and Muslim belongings might appear to be a highly particular, if not a parochial, set of experiences, they index a broader phenomena, how transnational processes are configuring forms of subjectivities, relations, and belongings that mark the complex interrelation between familial networks, ethno-national belonging, religious discursive traditions, labor migration, and cosmopolitan formations. Slipping between existing categories and frameworks of analysis, these forms are often overlooked and elided by existing scholarship, yet, as I have only just begun discussing here, transnational feminist approaches both push and enable us to begin grappling with them. So, thank you.
I'm really excited that so many people are here. I feel really humbled and grateful to be amongst so many brilliant thinkers who have influenced me, and so happy to honor the work that Karen and Inderpal have produced together, and also to acknowledge the kind of mentoring that I have greatly benefited from both of them, and also that I take as a model for the kind of scholarship and sort of way of being in the academy as I sort of start my career. And I also wanted to say thanks to Catherine and Attiya for inviting me to participate, and to the BCRW staff for organizing everything so smoothly. So I've been thinking a lot about what might be most useful and productive to bring to conversation at this conference, and what kinds of questions I might be able to raise in response to the changing theoretical landscapes that our panel is charged with engaging. So I come to these questions as someone in transgender studies, which is an interdisciplinary and arguably still emerging field. And so I've been thinking a lot recently about field formation and field development in relation to my primary field. So I thought what I might do with my time is to sort of briefly outline some provisional, partial, preliminary thoughts about some of the ways that I think the field is developing, what a transnational feminist framework might bring to that development, and some things that I think trans studies might be able to contribute to transnational feminist practices. And I'll try to use a few examples from my newest work that's still in progress to sort of explain the relationships that I'm looking at. So one of the things to think about is that as transgender studies becomes institutionalized, which is a process we can see marked in part by things like the creation of specific job titles, the publication of anthologies, the creation of undergraduate majors and minors, and programs that are specifically named as transgender studies, that transgender solidifies into an increasingly familiar category, right? And for many of us, these developments are really exciting and energizing because they constitute a kind of institutional recognition and support and resources that have been not available to us prior to this. And then alongside these kinds of institutional shifts in the academy, transgender is becoming more widely recognized as an identity category upon which various claims to rights and recognition can rest, and through which various individuals and populations can become legible. So as this category becomes more familiar to us, then feminist scholarship and pedagogy and activism will often take it up as a sort of self-evident tool of analysis, which in some ways can be useful. It prompts sometimes some kind of critical revision or reflection, right? Does this work account for transgender people? Is this political framework transphobic? But in doing that, it also comes to seem like a fairly stable and knowable category itself, so that the process of recognition and legibility often also entails sort of concretizing this category of transgender, and this often occurs in a Western medical legal context that gets universalized and then projected across time and space. So the transgender person or identity or body can now sort of appear readily legible as transgender, but that increasingly constitutes the proper object of the field, and that's sort of where I am trying to work, right, at that sort of limit. So in my current research, which explores the transnational production and circulation of synthetic hormones, I'm trying to open new questions for transgender studies that don't take the category for granted, but rather engage its production. So by tracing the uneven flows through which hormones and their accompanying narratives move, I'm aiming to unravel the processes by which transgender is consolidated into a legible and stable category. So for example, one thing that I've been looking at is the East German doping scandals in international sport in the 1970s and 80s, which regularly reappears in US media and public discourse, usually around the Olympics, so right now. And even though scores of female-assigned athletes took steroids as part of the East German national sporting program, US narratives of this process or event focus heavily on one athlete in particular, who is Andreas Krieger, who's the only athlete on that national team who is specifically identified now as transgender. And I use identified as because it does seem that he identifies himself in that way, but it also seems that that identity has been applied to him, right? Overwhelmingly, these narratives about Krieger try to uncover both the truth of the steroids program itself and especially the truth of Krieger's gender identity. Because his gender identity is viewed as questionable, right? And it's viewed as questionable because his masculinity would seem to be coercively created through hormones that were forcibly prescribed by, in these narratives, the repressive communist state, right? So sublimating his sort of individual choices to the needs of the state. So rather than seeking an answer to whether or not Krieger is rightly transgender, I'm more interested in asking how those very investigations into a true gender identity as constructed through hormonal status reflect US exceptionalism in various interrelated ways. First, the repeated linking of medicalization and gender changes relies on a Western medical discourse in which gender and sex are frequently collapsed, and medical intervention is what makes possible a recognizable gender shift. This leaves little room for understandings of gender that might escape or exceed the parameters designated by a sort of dominant Western medical and legal discourse. Second, the framing of Krieger as a victim of the state, and for example, news articles will repeatedly name his situation as a process of killing, literally killing his former sort of identity as a woman, right? So casting him as a victim suggests that the most tragic and criminal aspect of the steroid program was the state's denial of Krieger's freedom to choose his own gender. This sets up a naturalized conception of transgender identity modeled on ideals of individual choice, autonomy, and agency that's seemingly free from state coercion, right? So by setting the liberatory space of the US against the repressive communist state of East Germany, these narratives then also obscure the United States' own repressive state practices and coercive mechanisms that regulate, contain, and classify gendered bodies, whether those practices are transgender specific or not. So this kind of critique of exceptionalism seems to me to be one of the things that transgender studies is poised to offer in a really helpful way. As Susan Stryker and Aaron Azura have noted, one of the strengths of the critical lens of transgender studies, if it's being done, in my opinion, well, is to put as much pressure on the categories of man and woman as it does on the category of transgender, leveraging a transgender critique to unseat those categories of gender and sexuality, and I would suggest race, ability, and citizenship, that might be naturalized through their apparent contrast to transgender. But as the field coalesces, transgender comes to seem more and more like a naturalized category of difference, so that gender transgressions of a certain form are collapsed into transgender, or into maybe like a third gender category that's set up as parallel or oppositional to the West, where this category typically either supports Western ideals of gender normativity in contrast to what's happening over there, or it signals a kind of liberation from those norms that are projected globally. In these practices, transgender becomes a way of recognizing difference that also assumes and reinscribes difference within normative Western gender schemas. I think we could also consider the emergence of transgender as a global identity in a similar light, right? It's used as a touchstone for political organizing, but it can also uphold a particular form of difference through the creation of this broad homogenizing category. And I also think about this in terms of pedagogy all the time. How can I best teach these concepts without creating new sets of binaries and oppositions and assume differences to get sort of mired in? So one of the questions, and I think this is a concern that threads through our whole panel, is about how to navigate this problem of legibility and recognition. And one way that I've been trying to approach this is by starting to look at what hormones themselves as material substances that move through bodies and across national boundaries in the processes of research, manufacturing, marketing, and sale and consumption can tell us about the conditions about which, through which gendered categories are produced and regulated. So for instance, I've been examining how synthetic hormones circulate in relation to the US war on drugs and border control practices. And this kind of work often entails reading transgender into or alongside texts and events that might at first seem well beyond the field's scope, right? But what this is actually what's proven useful to me so far because it's created space for me to explore what trans studies might look like without specially identified transgender texts or subjects at the center. So for instance, transgender identities and bodies do not appear in the US state's rationale for classifying synthetic testosterone as a federally controlled substance in the early 1990s. But if we look closely at the legal discourse, anxieties about normative gender, especially as linked to racialized ideals of national health and security, and the potential for synthetic hormones to disrupt that imagined normative gender figure prominently. And these anxieties occur in relation to fears of unchecked mobility and bodies, mobility of bodies and capital as certain drugs circulate within and across national borders, a collection of threats that help justify the state's creation of specific channels through which synthetic testosterone can legally move. So in its efforts to control a particular chemical substance, the US state also works to shore up borders, whether these are borders of the body, borders of the category of gender, borders of the nation, so that restricting the circulation of hormones also entails restricting the mobility of certain bodies and populations. But because synthetic hormones have a really long history of transnational production, marketing, and sale, state efforts to more tightly control these chemicals occur simultaneously with the hormones' increased mobility across these porous boundaries. So there are ways that these state practices come to bear directly on the transgender identified in ways that can illuminate the criminalization and the pathologization of gendered bodies that are viewed as threateningly mobile. But attending to the movement of the drugs themselves also requires consideration of other deeply related forms of mobility as bodies, materials, and knowledges cross into and out of the space of the United States and play a role in the construction of that space in ways that may seem at first unrelated to transgender concerns. A more complex understanding of these regulations means drawing out the connections between hormonal practices and policies specifically aimed at transgender-identified people and those constraining or enabling other forms of hormonal transition. So some of the other things that I'm starting to look at in this project include chemical castration policies for certain sexual offenses, which were developed originally in the US and the UK and have recently emerged in places such as India, Argentina, Australia, and South Korea. Public health campaigns focused on metabolic syndrome as a hormonally based threat to national health, and military uses of synthetic testosterone both during deployment, unofficially, and as treatment for veterans. This means expanding transgender studies beyond what is currently intelligible as transgender and reimagining what that category might entail. I'm finding that attention to the life of a chemical substance, rather than focusing only on the bodies or identities that consume that substance, has helped me shift my analysis away from a universalized transgender person or identity, and away from a sort of proper set of texts that would seem available to me. Instead, opening up new questions about how knowledge, bodies, and materials travel and interact. So it's been a really helpful way for me of beginning to refuse a proper object of study, and instead of creating a space to understand transgender as a practice or a framework, rather than as a clearly defined object or identity. And so I really appreciated the way that Tina described this morning, described transnational not as an object, but as a practice or a process. So I don't really have a conclusion, but I wanted to say that I'm still just at the edges of the research that I described today, but so far it's been really promising for me to sort of think expansively about the field that I'm in and what its possibilities are. And if folks are interested, I would love to hear other sort of approaches that people have found generative to answer this question of legibility and recognition and other interventions that have been useful. Thanks.
I would like first to start to thank Attiya and Caroline for the invitation. I'm very happy to be here and to take part, to be part of these conversations. Conversations that revolve around the question of transnational feminist mobilization, and I think part of that is also to bring the kind of conversations that somehow inform your own work and that are very much, I think, also determined by your specific location. And I think the kind of presentation that I want to do now is very much also determined by my specific location, and this is Western Europe. Our times are marked by interesting, though discomforting, paradoxes. One of them concerns the question of diversity, at least in continental Europe in general, and the Low Countries, so I'm based in Belgium in particular. While the concern over the growing heterogeneous composition of European populations seems to be on everybody's lips, and we have never been as well equipped conceptually, politically, and methodologically to address these issues, the question of diversity is a contested one, as can be testified through the multiple crises of multiculturalism which have succeeded each other over the recent years. Interrogations that seem to be less about the desirability of a pluralistic society, but rather seem to point towards the applicability of the once cherished model of multiculturalism, especially when it comes to the question of Islam. The idea that Islam holds a contentious relationship to Europe's liberal values is by no means new and builds upon a much older historical legacy that considers this religious system as Europe's other. The growing public visibility of Muslim minorities, who are the offspring of the post-colonial migrants, have, however, exacerbated some of these historical contradictions and placed them in a new political conjuncture. A large part of the tensions that accompany the question of multiculturalism are deeply marked by this changing reality and the sentiment shared by many that Europe is at the verge of undergoing a process of Islamization. The polarizing discourses that surround the Muslim question have consequently become so central to any thinking about multiculturalism that it has become virtually impossible to escape this question when the question of diversity of difference comes to be addressed. These anxieties become particularly clear when the question of gender comes to be addressed. More than any other religious tradition, Islam has been particularly prone to the opinion on interrogation on whether multiculturalism is good or bad for women. Countless numbers of researchers, ethnographies, and sociological analyses have sought to address this question, often by documenting the emancipatory dynamics that exist among Muslim groups and showing that multiculturalism, a code word for Islam, may, after all, be not that bad. Yet by maintaining these conversations within such an epistemological and political interrogative framework, the multiple trajectories of Muslim population tend to become obscured. Debating the question of Islam and its relationship to the women's question becomes reduced to the possibility and ability to show that Muslims are adapting to the narrative of modernity and its accompanying key value, feminism. Other modes of being, which do not necessarily comfort these liberal sensibilities, are either ignored or viewed as fundamentalist ignominies. So what I want to do is to try to think through this circumvented epistemological space, to conceptualize and think through this question of difference, a question of difference that becomes particularly sensitive when the issue of Islam is raised, and even more so when it is tied to the woman's question. For assuming the existence of difference within these questions provides equally a ground for a renewed opportunities to assert conservative claims about the incommensurability between Islam and the West. And I think that's a bit the kind of epistemological deadlock I find myself in writing today. By reflecting upon some of these conceptual and epistemological tensions, I also want to somehow contribute to this question of critique and equally further the discussion about the role of feminist scholarship in this respect. So more than three decades have passed since the publication of Edward Said's important work, Orientalism. His insights on the role of Western European academic knowledge production on the symbolic and discursive construction of the Orient have become part of our well-rehearsed vocabularies, and a large body of work has built upon those insights by attending to the antagonistic representations between the West and the Orient. A central trope identified within this legacy has been the question of sexuality and gender. While Orientalism and its scholarly legacy has produced a large awareness about the ways in which sexuality acts as one of the key tropes through which the idea of an ontological difference is asserted, feminist and women's studies have been particularly prone to examine how these have enabled new forms of domination or colonial feminism. Confronted with this given, a large body of literature has sought to demarcate itself from such contentious and conflicting positions by challenging them as essentializing representations and insisting upon the existence of emancipatory dynamics within Islam. A deep desire to show that Muslims are not that different from us, and that they are endorsing our values of emancipation seems therefore to prefigure as privileged starting points in a large body of this literature. Over the recent years, however, some scholarly attempts have sought to critically unpack the dominant significations attributed to this question of emancipation by documenting heterogeneous trajectories that do not necessarily comfort this dominant consensus. And the key seminal intervention in this respect, and here I join also, it picks up upon where Attiya has left at, a key seminal intervention in this respect has been Saba Mahmoud's Politics of Piety. This much-commented study, which offers an ethnography of pious Muslim women in Egypt, has played a key role in redefining the question of agency and emancipation in the field of women's studies, and has provoked many discussions about the possibility of conceptualizing this question beyond liberal terms. So in her theoretical argumentation, Mahmoud has contributed to decentering this notion by opening it up to other, less obvious ways to think about the question of the self. But more fundamentally, the question that her work poses is that of the translatability of these differences. And the possibility to decenter our concept of agency in order to consider and envision other ways of being. It is to this possibility that I wish to turn by briefly referring to two recent critical contributions that have appeared and that critically engage with this question and works like those of Mahmoud. So in looking at these two specific works, I'm not really interested in the kind of controversy, so that's not really it. But what I'm really interested in is the kinds of reactions, works that try to place a question of difference in relationship to Islam and the woman's question, the kind of reaction these kind of work trigger and what they are indicative of about the possibility to think about these questions. The first work I want to briefly refer that is to is Christian Jopke's Veil Mirror of Identity, who is a well-known political scientist based in Europe. And he engages with a number of challenges he considers to be proper to Islam's public visibility in the European public space. To Jopke, the West's anxiety about Islam should not simply be read as a reaction to the growing assertiveness of Muslim claims in the public sphere. He rather considers these anxieties to follow from a number of characteristics that he sees to be proper to Islamic norms and values and which remain irreconcilable with European liberal values, and especially in the domain of women's rights and gender norms. To Jopke, there exist clear and unavoidable contradictions in this domain. Contradictions that do not necessarily reside in a number, that do not only reside in a number of theological prospects, but which are also derived from some recent anthropological studies on the hijab or women's participations. And so he cites a number of authors in that respect and studies, and the key intervention that he cites in that respect is the work of Saba Mahmoud, on whom he largely draws. Although he acknowledges and understands the critical attempts made by scholars like Mahmoud to decenter reigning conceptions of agency, he views such critical deconstructions as nothing more than, and I'm quoting here, learned but arcane prose, unquote, that does not do away with, quote, the fact that female subordination and affirmation of patriarchy is still the outcome, end of quote. To Jopke, this work offers evidence of a number of incommensurable realities that might help explaining the anxiety many Europeans today have towards Islam. Another example that shows the difficulty of addressing this question of difference when it comes to the women's question in general and Islam in particular can be found in a noted essay by Sindre Bakstad entitled Saba Mahmoud and Anthropological Feminism After Virtue. And so, as the title of his work suggests, this essay can be read as a direct and explicit engagement with the work of Mahmoud, a work the author contends which poses a number of challenges to the possibility of considering emancipatory dynamics within Islam. In difference to Jopke, though, Bakstad doesn't take the claims of difference observed by Mahmoud as evidence for an incompatibility between Islam and Europe. Rather, he disqualifies Mahmoud's observations as post-colonial scholarly projections driven by the desire to maintain the possibility of difference between Islam and liberal secularity. But besides disqualifying Mahmoud's work as ethnographically thin and being driven by a political agenda, Bakstad's critical engagement is equally driven by what he considers a lack of explicit and clear feminist engagement in the work of Mahmoud. At various occasions, Mahmoud will be accused of neglecting the feminist agenda through her apologetic stance towards what he calls Salafi Islam and other conservative tendencies, a position he takes to be informed by a desire to debunk Western secular feminism, which to him remains incompatible with a feminist agenda, as he suggests that there is, and I'm quoting here, simply no way to reconcile feminism with a perspective which appears to preservation of life forms over women's rights, end of quote. So what is interesting for me here is not just simply to illustrate a controversy that is ongoing now in European scholarship and that is triggered by a number of recent contributions. What is interesting for me is more the kind of tensions that laying claim to the question of difference produces and triggers. Whereas these claims of difference become captured and mobilized as evidence for incommensurability in the case of Jopke, these are viewed as fraught scholarly projections in the case of Bakstad. What both positions, however, reveal is the difficulty to envision scholarly roots that neither address this question of emancipation nor seek to deploy an explicit feminist agenda, for these are viewed as either an illustration of Islam's intolerable difference or as post-colonial anti-Western projections. The language of feminism and gender seems in these very specific contexts to operate as a conditioning language that determines Islam and Muslims' acceptability, rather than an analytical frame that allows us to think through the question of difference in its various forms. Such a discursive context therefore bears the question as to the possibility of engaging with certain aspects of Islam's difference, where at times where the Muslim question seems to have turned into one of the main fault lines within various European countries. Besides contributing to a further problematization of these minority groups, the observations made here point at the difficulty of acknowledging and pointing at these elements without being recuperated by essentializing and polarizing discourse. One of the central questions that therefore preoccupy me at this moment is what are the possibilities to conceptualize this question of difference, especially in relationship to the Muslim subject, when the latter acts as the archetypical trope through which difference comes to be coded. And when thinking about this difference might equally provide a ground for the exclusion of these subjectivities within the public sphere. And so I'm speaking at a time where Muslim subjects who are deemed illiberal are not just stripped off or might be stripped off from their nationalities, but might be limited from their participation within society, etc. And secondly, what is the role of feminist scholarship and critique in this respect, especially considering its commitment to thematize, but equally unpack difference in the quest for transnational grounds of solidarity? Thank you.
Well, first, I want to join in the long line of those who have thanked the wonderful organizers of this conference, the BCRW, and also Karen Inderpal, and all the other incredible scholars here today. Participating in this conference has been extraordinarily generative and intellectually invigorating for me, and I feel incredibly honored to have been invited, as I'm sure a lot of us do. It's been fantastic. A crucial component of transnational feminist work has been the destabilization of binaries, male, female, first world, third world, center, periphery. As Inderpal and Karen argued in the landmark anthology that provides inspiration for our meeting today, a central problem of global feminism is its reliance on a unified narrative of history or power. Yet in a postmodern and certainly in a late capitalist neoliberal world, hegemony does not occupy one single location. It is necessarily multiple and scattered. As an anthropologist working in New Caledonia, it's not difficult for me to understand hegemonies as scattered. I thought you might need to see that. And also as simultaneous, conflicting, and complexly imbricated. New Caledonia is an island archipelago in Melanesia in the South Pacific. It is also a French settler colony that the indigenous Kanak people, along with recent arrivals from metropolitan France and the descendants of early European settlers, all call home. Officially, New Caledonia's political status is that of a sui generis French overseas territory, but the island remains on the UN list of non-self-governing territories, which means the UN considers it to still be a colony. Sometime before 2018, the population of New Caledonia will vote in a referendum on independence from France. For the Kanak, who have struggled for over a century to articulate and defend their identities within the structures of a French colonial regime, the stakes are high. Over half the indigenous population of New Caledonia is under 30. They have experienced rapid cultural transformation, increased access to globalized media and Western commercial goods, and mass migration from rural tribal communities to Noumea, the territory's only urban center. They also have no firsthand memory of the events, which is the name given to the violent struggle for indigenous independence that brought New Caledonia to the brink of civil war during the 1980s. Depending on their perspective, today's Kanak young people are perched at either the edge of a utopia or a void. As a generation, they're shaped by a sense of their newness, as you can see by this graffiti, but they don't see this newness as evidence of a radical break with Kanak culture. My own research specifically focuses on the ways that Kanak youth negotiate their socially and politically precarious position
through involvement in cultural production, primarily music and dance groups, both traditional dance and also hip hop. And all of these groups are officially registered as associations under French law, which means that they can apply for and receive funding from the French government. And here's one of these groups performing at a neighborhood venue out in one of the primarily Kanak neighborhoods of Nouméa. As cultural producers, indigenous youth creatively engage the structures of the French colonial state and transform them in ways that make alternative indigenous futures possible. I approach cultural production as a form of labor undertaken by Kanak youth in order to create a space for indigenous sovereignty. Their labor is a difficult one. As a French settler state, New Caledonia presents a unique set of obstacles, not only to indigenous sovereignty, but to assertions of indigeneity in general. The French Republican model of citizenship assumes the indivisible sovereignty of the Republic and the universal equality of all citizens. Each individual is envisioned as engaged in a direct republic, in a direct relationship with the state, which should seek to serve only the general interest of all individuals together, rather than the particular interests of groups. As many scholars have described, French republicanism, specifically through the principle of laïcité, blocks the use of many forms of difference, cultural, religious, and ethnic, as the bases of collective mobilization and political claims making in the public sphere. Consequently, the structures of the French state leave very little space for indigeneity, which is fundamentally premised on difference and the relationship between culture and rights. Moreover, France has long considered culture as the proper domain of national public policy. The French state sees culture as an important tool for animating civic life and integrating citizens into a cohesive national identity. And this is particularly interesting because the political accord that actually set forth the date for the future referendum on independence is known as the Nouméa Accord. And sort of the key phrase in that accord is that all the populations of the territory must work towards a common destiny. But that common destiny, rather than being a destiny that includes a particular place for the indigenous population as sovereign subjects in their homeland, instead has been sort of reimagined as an integrationalist Republican project of a common destiny that inevitably ends up looking much more French than indigenous. So New Caledonia thus offers a very different frame for theorizing settler colonialism, indigeneity, and sovereignty than Latin American or Anglo-settler contexts, where liberal multiculturalism is a dominant state frame for managing difference and granting rights, and the state is far less involved in cultural policy. New Caledonia also offers a different and exceptionally generative frame for feminist critique. And this is something that I'm increasingly trying to think about in my own research. The young Kanak women I work with expertly navigate the simultaneous and overlapping hegemonic structures of settler colonialism, French republicanism, and also traditional Kanak customary authority, which constructs urban youth, particularly young women, as delinquent cultural and political subjects. In many ways, the Kanak b-girls in basketball shorts and free Kanaki t-shirts I saw dance battling each week in Nouméa's central square trouble Kanak discourses of indigenous sovereignty as much as they do the hegemony of the French Republican settler state. At the same time, these young women negotiate their identities and imagine possible futures, both for themselves and for their homeland, within and through these structures. In order to understand these futures, in order perhaps to help bring them into being, we must continue to reassess how we think about the state and its relationship to many forms of difference. Some of the most productive work in this vein has come from the growing number of scholars integrating feminist and queer theory with indigenous and settler colonial studies, such as Andrea Smith, Scott Loria Morganson, Kehlani Kahanui, and Dean Spade, just to name a few. Native feminists have complicated the politics of decolonization by noting that Native women are often marginalized within these projects. Amongst Kanak political and customary leaders, for instance, addressing issues of gender violence or equal political rights for women is often seen as secondary or even as detracting from or in opposition to the goal of Kanak sovereignty. When I attended the first Canuck Youth Congress, which was held in 2010 and organized by the Canuck Customary Senate, several of the young female delegates present tried to initiate a conversation about the widespread problem of gang rapes of young Canuck women and the fact that these incidents, more often than not, went unpunished within customary courts, even if they were punished within the French legal system. One of the customary authorities present, a tribal chief, interrupted the young women who were speaking to say, "This is a Congress about Canuck youth, not women. We should focus on the issues facing youth and the future of Kanaki." As Andrea Smith notes, Native movements in the United States often position gender justice as something to be addressed after decolonization. In this way, she argues, quote, "A politics of futurity sacrifices the lives of women and those who are not gender normative for the indefinitely postponed post-colonial future," end quote. In New Caledonia, the possibility of a successful independence referendum and a sovereign state of Kanaki are similarly focused on securing a particular form of the future that allows for political leaders to excuse injustice in the present. I flash back to this moment at the Kanak Youth Congress later on during my fieldwork when I attended a march organized by leaders of the Kanak independence and trade union movements and saw this banner, which reads roughly in English, "Colonization is rape by the state, pure in all its savagery, but above all, it's a crime against humanity that we don't want to bear. Their common destiny, it is the utter deception of a rapist who remains unpunished, who wants to absolve his crime by proposing marriage to his victim as reparation." In this way, the struggle against the violation of indigenous sovereignty is likened to rape by the settler colonial state, at the same time as protecting Kanak women from rape in the present is seen as a distraction from a sovereign indigenous future. Similarly to the interventions made by scattered hegemonies and subsequent transnational feminist scholarship, those working at the intersection of feminist, queer, and Native studies adopt a mode of analysis that offers an option beyond binaries, beyond the either-or of equality versus revolutionary, of universal and particular, beyond engaging in an oppositional politics of emancipation as only one kind of subject. In this vein, Dean Spade speaks of the effectiveness of what he, drawing on Chela Sandoval, calls tactical subjectivity, the strategic use of various forms to move power. This is a subjectivity I see being negotiated by many of the young female Kanak cultural producers I work with. They are, in Spade's words, quote, "traveling across worlds of meaning, shuttling between systems of understanding identity, and engaging narratives strategically with an underlying commitment to equalizing power between social constituencies. Indeed, if hegemony is multiple, then anti-hegemonic movements must be as well." Thanks.
So it's, of course, exciting and exhilarating, but equally intimidating to be the last speaker of such a wonderful weekend. But first of all, of course, many thanks to both Attiya and Catherine for organizing this incredible conference. But also really a special thank you to BCRW, particularly Janet, Anne, Pam, Hope. It's hard to talk about the big bad world out there when you have such a great and generative, affective, and intellectual home in your institution. So I really am deeply grateful to BCRW. Also, I will apologize in advance. There is some video, but both in the interest of time, you may see me skipping ahead. And it's also roughly edited together. So I've tried to subtitle it as best as I can because the sound quality is not the best. But you'll get the gist of it, even if you don't understand every word. Because as a performance scholar, I always tell my students, unless you see it, you really don't understand it. So however the quality, we'll try and sort of plod through. So today I'll be talking about a feminist avant-garde performing and protesting the law in India. Our panel here today is tasked with situating transnational feminism in a changing theoretical landscape. Indeed, as the plenary speakers urged, ever-present and ever-pressing are the ways in which we are alert and attendant to the question of how to be political. And as the theoretical legacies of scattered hegemonies by Grewal and Kaplan have directed, And as Tina Campt feelingly reminded us this morning, the transnational approach already always folds within it a critique of the nation. My colleagues and I have spent substantial caffeine fuel hours this weekend trying to decode and unpack the ways in which critique functions. What forms does it take? What intellectual and affective labors does it encompass? How does it circulate and mediate? And here too, like with every panel probably you've attended, there are no easy answers. But we have agreed to let our awareness of a collective stickiness not confound us into negative skepticism or lapse us into easy positivisms, but instead prompt us to share some generative and enabling practices, tactics, and strategies of critique, however limiting. In this task, I am interested then in not so much the changes in the theoretical frameworks, but in the recurrences, reverberations, and the redeployments of them, and how these are related, particularly, and I think this is what's interesting, to our relation with modernity itself and this vexed Enlightenment legacies that we have in terms of the social sphere. This is not to echo a rhetoric of growth, collapse, and regeneration that late capitalism has so successfully sold as the conceit of economic cycles, but rather it is to pry open the historical and political disjunctures between different instances of citational feminist practice for a fuller estimation of the current social world. I will do so today through a brief sampling of techniques used by performers and activists in recent protests around women's and queer rights in India, particularly in the last year. What interests me is the resurfacing of earlier modes of protest around demands for legality, legibility, and participation of marginalized communities, and the legal discursive framework such articulations employ. In particular, I look at the work of actor, director, comedian, performance artist Maya Krishna Rao, and present a genealogy of her aesthetics here as a gateway to understanding questions of rights and representations in contemporary India. The feminist avant-garde, as I identify a set of theater practitioners and performance artists in New Delhi, was shaped by the women's movements of the 1980s. And here I have to say that really my work so far has been in documenting and understanding some of this earlier work. So the research I present today is far more new, and I was just struck by the parallels between the work of the 80s and now. The first wave of Indian feminism in the 1970s had been spurred by a 1974 United Nations report on the status of women. Mobilization centered itself primarily around developmental issues such as women's health, education, nutrition, access to employment, etc. Interrupted by the national emergency, the second wave reconstituted itself around a shifting theoretical framework, one of personal agency and subjectivity. Bringing a heterogeneous spectrum of scholars, activists, and artists together, this broad coalition too was responding to a crisis narrative: the imminent danger to the lives and dignities of women through spectacular, often read as pre-modern modes of violence, such as dowry deaths and sati, both versions of bride burning. But in fact, such fatal practices were harnessing an archaic iconography to legitimize contradictions brought about by the inequities of neoliberal policy. India opened its markets to foreign investment in the 1980s, and civic population began the seemingly inexorable conversion to consumers first and citizens later. Feminist critique through the works of Veena Das and others worked to undercut the exceptionalism of such violences, to point instead to the range of everyday violences that women faced. Political activist and scientist Nivedita Menon diagnosed the work of that era as, quote, particularly in the 1980s, the women's movement reacted to almost every instance of violence against women by demanding legislative action. It is inevitable that these concerns with the law and the ways in which discourses of legality affect the female body are reflected in the feminist plays of this period. Theatre Union, of which Maya Rao, who I will talk about more later, collaborated with grassroots activists in the women's movement with its seminal play Om Swaha on the issues of dowry death or the horrific fatalities committed against women who were deemed to have brought inadequate bridal wealth into their marital homes. Om Swaha was staged in the round, actors used their bodies and minimal props to create key images, And in fact, this, you know, at the time, this kind of aesthetic seemed fairly revolutionary, particularly a woman's group going out to the streets. And in the subsequent years, since we've somehow conventionalized these theater practices. The legislative framework of earlier mobilization had already started to dissipate by the late 1980s, where the disillusionment with the law, the state's inability to interpret it, and the court's inherent conservatism in legislating it scattered the political agendas of various women's rights groups. Alexander and Mohanty have starkly outlined this tangled relationality of women's movements to the state with their influential book, Feminist Genealogies, Colonial Legacies, where in the third world, it is impossible for feminists to fully disengage with the state, as it is often the only guarantor of rights and recourse to intervention in the lives of women. Maya Rao's own work turned to the aesthetic of the global avant-garde, postmodernist in its approach, deconstructionist in its narrative. And you will see this is sort of what the program notes said, and this is a very familiar sort of, if you track sort of avant-garde iterations across the world at different times, it's similar kinds of aesthetics, right? The breakdown of narrative, the use of multiple techniques, juxtaposition, there is no one way to construct meaning, but much more this contingent approach. Far from an apolitical and apathetic avant-garde, and of course this is always the argument that's made, right? That the avant-garde is in fact apolitical. These were real violences with real-world consequences. Maya Rao, without actually undressing her viewers, uses this clip within the larger pastiche of her digital work. And they have this sign which says, "The Indian Army, they rape us." The state of exception and the rhetoric of crisis, however, once again emerges in the wake of the widespread protests following the gang rape of a young medical student in December 2012. The Justice Verma Commission, tasked with laying guidelines for an amendment to the antiquated rape law, delivered, in fact, a speedy, thorough, and scathing assessment. It squarely cited the failure of governance as the primary cause of violence against women. By once again yoking the various institutions of governance and civil society to questions of everyday life, Justice Verma made some profoundly progressive and for that time profoundly sort of hopeful recommendations. These included expanding rape laws to include custodial rape, military rape, marital rape, and employer compensation for sexual harassment. None of these were finally included in the law that was subsequently passed. In The Walk, a piece made in response to the Delhi gang rape in a moving bus, Maya Rao visits some of these same themes, and particularly the idea of consent. And you'll see this is sort of a fairly flexible creature performs in different venues.
One step at a time. Not five, not six, not nine, not ten, not 11. At 12 midnight, I want to walk the streets of the city. Give me 6 34 convictions.
give me a law that lets me live freely, right? And at the same time, in the same political sphere, we have Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code being upheld, right? This is after a lower court in Delhi had already overturned it. The Supreme Court comes out and says, well, in fact, this colonial law is valid. So part of what's interesting to me is this idea, and I cite the wiki, I know that that's problematic, but the idea that the wiki itself is a contested space, and you can see it very actively in India, the idea of the wiki commons and the promise for it. So you'll see that here, particularly, what's interesting is it talks about the law, but in the very opening sentence also inserts criminalizes sexual activities against the order of nature, arguably including homosexual acts, right? So the interpretation along with the word of the law. So another crisis in the legality of social life came from the ratification of 377, widely construed as the anti-colonial, anti-sodomy laws. I'm going to skip a little ahead in the interest of time because I want to show you the last little clip. But the idea that nationwide pride parades were once again witnessed the return to the juridical framework for mounting their demands. And so over and over again, even though these practices, as we see both pride parades, and I'll quickly show you a couple of images from, this is one of my favorites. This is Slut Walk, which is fabulously translated as Besharmi Morcha. It's impossible to translate except as a real sort of a call to action. And so even though some of these tactics, we see obviously that they're circulating in different contexts, a certain framework, particularly the legalistic framework, is redeployed again and again. So while recognizing the limitations of this legislative discourse, we must also, as feminists and scholars, work to undergird such articulations by the historical conditions of utterance. If nothing, transnational feminism has taught us that careful citationality of protest tactics and that such strategic deployments, rather than flattening out regional differences, become agile instead in negotiating rapidly changing political landscapes, especially as they are charted today through social and virtual media. Hybrid performance strategies, whether as conventional street theater or as feminist avant-garde, come together, recongregating in our collective creative urban commons, fighting for social change. Thank you.
Thanks to all the panelists for the great papers and presentations. We've got about 15 minutes for questions and conversations. So
one thing that strikes me, particularly in Tate, your paper, and Shayoni, and well, all of them really is, I don't know how else to say it, but the, making legible things that are just erased, either in, as you say, Tate, I think really eloquently, these two choices that activists and subjects often feel themselves caught in between, either to identify with, you know, movements that don't fully represent them or state power that also erases.
I could add to that. Yeah. Well, I mean, just going back to the title of the panel, which has to do with the shifting landscape, theoretical landscape, that what I was wondering is, and it goes directly to your question about legibility and translatability. It's the question, when you were thinking about this panel or when you were thinking about your presentations and how they might relate to each other, what is shifting? Is the theoretical landscape shifting? Are movements in motion in a certain particular ways that are in motion? And so in each of your presentations, you're pointing to a kind of juxtaposition and a contradiction. Right, a political contradiction and a historical contradiction, and in your case also a discursive contradiction. So I just want to hear you guys talk more about what's shifting theoretically for you? What's the slippery part in relationship to the different cultural and political phenomena that you're talking about?
I think to Catherine's earlier point of this, we talked about this at fair length yesterday as well, is what exactly are the stakes of legibility, mm-hmm. right? That on one hand, there seems to be, in many of our instances, this desire for legibility, but with that comes a certain forcible reinscription into models and categories that are already problematic. Mm-hmm. And I think particularly in the Indian case, it was depressing when I was doing this because I thought, didn't we get past this moment of the law is really not going to do much for us, right? And yet it comes all rushing back the minute there's this perceived crisis or exceptionalism. So it's, I think, very much that the sort of troubling recurrence, but obviously the landscape is shifting economically, in a troubling way globally. Mm-hmm. And I think my way, and I don't fully understand it yet, but really has been to see how do you strategically redeploy certain tactics, right? Mm-hmm. What is the weight of history? What is the weight of expectation that certain tactics bring with them again?
Well, I think, it's a very, two things. I think on the one hand, there is maybe the element that you also briefly addressed, and that is what has changed. I think there is a certain degree of having reached a point of theoretical and political saturation, right? And that there are, and that's the thing that we also basically pointed at a workshop yesterday, that there is a sense of being stuck in a number of and going around circles, and also in terms of what is critique and what is politics. Okay, critique is about deconstruction, but if you just do deconstruction, what is then the alternative? But the alternative, as you say, is also informed by categories that define problematic. So how do you basically get out of that circle? And I think on the other hand, there is also the element of working in a context where deconstructivist approaches are the very modality through which new forms of exclusions are being legitimated and enabled. And I think that's very much the context in which I'm working, right? Where it's very much, well, Islam is not that different, right? And it's really that kind of claim that enables new forms of exclusion and that enables bans on the veil and that enables critiques on specific Muslim subjectivities just for their ability to exist and enables forms of assimilation politics, right? And I think that's I don't know to which extent it is very much a different place, but I would say that for me that is very much what is at stake politically, and how do you translate that into scholarship, because clearly you're not going to lay claims for essentialism. That's not the position you're going to advocate. But how do you then work with tools that at the same time are very much the adversaries that you're up with? I think that's...
Thank you for that amazing panel. The question I have is for either Attiya or Nadia, either one of you can answer. This issue of looking at Muslim women's experiences, my particular research focuses on looking at Sufism or Islamic mysticism as an epistemological approach to women and gender studies. But for some odd reason, I'm still always sent back to writers like Saba Mahmood and the fact that it's considered a seminal work rather than, for example, someone like Sachiko Murata, who's done so much on using metaphysics as an approach to women's studies or feminist theory. What does that say about where our priorities are and this cyclical sort of theoretical cycle that we're stuck in?
I was really struck, I'm going to kind of link this to Tina's question about, you know, what's shifting. And, you know, the underlying argument of my paper is something really isn't shifting, right? That within the discipline that I'm in, there's a recurring modality of critique that's predicated on, you know, positing something in juxtaposition to a universalizing discourse where that's something that's localized, essentialized in particular ways. The configuration of difference that's predicated on as binarized forms of difference, and it kind of boxes us in conceptually, theoretically, into particular frameworks, rubrics, where you know certain works circulate and others don't, like the example you provided us with. And so for me, you know, as I mentioned in the paper, transnational feminist works have been seminal. Like it took me, I was always told not to use that word because of the gender dissociation, sorry. It's just been crucial, critical. And it took me a long, long time to figure this out, right? Because, you know, my own understanding is overdetermined by these very, both in terms of how I was disciplined as a graduate student, as an anthropologist, but also as a subject that is repeatedly subject to Orientalist and Islamophobic discourses that we always speak in relation to, and so on and so forth. And so it is this sort of stuckness of not shifting yet seeing possibilities, right? And I don't think at this point I can say very much more, but I share with you sort of the predicaments, right, and the stuckness, the stickiness. Again, what I found so enabling about this is just not assuming particular forms or modalities of difference, looking at how those are produced through particular historical moments, right, as a way of kind of unpacking and thinking through some of those stuff. And yeah, and just a little side note, I want to hear more about your research.
Thank you for that. It was very interesting to hear you all speak, because I was thinking about recently Judith Butler did a talk on public assembly in Toronto. And one of the questions that she posed that I think is a really important question is the very idea of how we theorize a we. And I think when we think about protest, when we think about sort of formations of how a public begins to challenge and the sort of the trajectory of that and how that can potentially become a really interesting archive, there's also other responsibilities, I think, that we have as, you know, as scholars and as activists, and that is sort of to acknowledge what gets excluded from those snapshots. And I think something that Judith Butler said that I really appreciated was, you know, a we is not just magically evoked, not only because that just, it doesn't work that way, but also because, you know, who are the excluded that could never be part of that assembly, right, that public assembly? And she was speaking directly to prisoners. But I think in this case, what's really interesting is, you know, both the hope in that the visualization of public assembly, but also to include the exclusion of what's not in that visualization. And there's not really a question there other than, you know, what you inspired in thinking about what she was talking about in terms of the exclusions of prisoners, but also in terms of, you know, how each of your pieces kind of work through theorizing a kind of rethinking of a we, right? And I think beyond the anthropological critique of, you know, the homogeneous we, but rather the we that purports to make social change. So it's kind of both a comment and maybe you can respond to this notion of public assembly.
Well, if I could quickly say something, which is, you know, maybe that is what has shifted in terms of what I'm looking at, is it seems almost nostalgic holding on to this idea of visualizing public assembly, right? Particularly if you credit virtual mediums as some form of congregation. So what is the sort of symbiotic relationship that you need to sort of occupy physical space? You need to sort of show strength in numbers. And it's such a throwback to sort of terminology that would seem dated, but it's not. And there's an incredible sort of power to that. So the we, as I think both, certainly in my work, as both the physical and the virtual, but how one sort of really just indexes the other.
Thanks for this panel and also today's workshop. I think today, it's from what I heard, it's compared to 20 years ago, we didn't have this concept of transnational feminism as a, you know, powerful tool to understand what's going on. And today, I think all the panels can address how we can use this concept to analyze, to understand what's going on. But at the same time, I also feel it's something kind of not addressed enough in today's, you know, in terms of what's shifting. For instance, the social content had changed so much 20 years ago and now.
let's say, you know, the race of a transnational corporation, right? We talk about transnational business masculinity. We're talking about regional economies. China, India, all the different Asian economies, also different kind of economies. And how this shape in terms today when we are talking about scatter homogeneous in terms, you know, relationships today mentioned about, it's, of course, it's not about West and East and North and South. It's much, much complex, especially, you know, the, all the regional economies have changed even how we see, for instance, I'm from Taiwan, East Asia, right? And you there now, I feel in the higher education, the relationship compared before and now, you know, there's so many universities from West, America, going to China, all the Asia countries to set up, because it's so much because of the economy there too. And I'm just trying to say, I think it's a lot of this kind of larger political economic force have been changed and also shift have influence between the, you know, women's group or gender movements also going on different kind of relationship around the different region and different societies, and that how have changed, how can we still use transnational feminism to understand this kind of shifting? And I think that's kind of somehow I feel a little bit missing today here. Yeah, it's just my sharing my thoughts. Thanks.
Well, I only have sort of a partial answer to your question. Maybe it's sort of alongside your question, but you know, yesterday when we were talking in our sort of small group workshops, we were talking about the ways that transnational gets interpreted in very different ways, partly depending on our disciplinary backgrounds or our institutional locations, and the ways that it might get taken up, you know, in ways that are really antithetical to what we might imagine it would do. And so I think, you know, since the book has come out, like I think that a lot of our conversations over the last 2 days have been about what does it mean to think about transnational as meaning all of these different things all at once and maybe not always the thing that we want it to mean. And I think that's why I wanted to do my presentation on the way that I see transgender sort of developing, because I see sort of that same, I think I see it going in a similar direction where it means things that it didn't mean at first, and it's sort of solidifying into this this sort of all-encompassing thing that they can't do what it could have done, right, if it keeps going down that path. And so I sort of want to learn from how other fields have become institutionalized and the sort of pitfalls that have been sort of contested, right, and try to sort of avoid some of those as I see transgender studies sort of congealing into an institutionalized field. So I know that was sort of skirting your question, but I've just been thinking about the relationship between these two terms and how they get used in different ways.
I'm so struck by the question itself that was posed to you, right? Which is a difficult one. It's so hard because in a way, asking you to think about shifts and newness and emergences is precisely also the imperative of academic structural violence in some ways that sort of sees value in some sense in newness, in novelty. And I'm struck by the way you all refused it in some way. And I'm wondering how one might think about institutional refusal rather than injunction to think theoretically about sort of the very different kinds of projects you're all engaged in.
I mean, I don't know whether it resonates, and it's a bit also what I wanted to say with the previous question. I think the first thing that I feel and where I think part of the saturation, or at least, I mean, clearly I'm situated in Europe and in a very specific conjuncture, but I think part of the challenge is to somehow engage with the ways in which our critical scholarship, and we can say maybe that we're the third generation or whatever of critical scholars has come to be, and it builds upon what you said, has come to be captured by the institutes, by the university institutes, and by so doing, it no longer draws or builds the kind of interrogations it relies upon or the kinds of questions it poses in direct connection with the kind of struggles that are taking place. I mean, critical scholarship has become docile, right? It's no longer threatening, it's no longer dangerous, or at least that's how I very much experience it. And sometimes it feels, being in Europe, it feels as a kind of living in a parallel world, where on the one hand you have this kind of critical scholarship, and on the other hand, when you step out of the university, you see all this kind of surreality coming over you. And I find that interesting. I find that parallelism very interesting. And I just wonder, and it comes to your question of refusal, because connecting these worlds, these parallel worlds, implies also refusing certain modes of accountability within academia, right? It implies maybe writing certain kinds of things or engaging with certain kinds of fora that are not accountable within the academic structure. And I think we are somehow also stuck in that. So I think that's somehow something that might be something we can take up.
Please again thank the panelists, thank BCRW and all the others.